Yeah, so now in numerical methods, I like to start with computer arithmetic. So we don't start with numerical methods. We start at looking on how a computer actually calculates or how your mathematical formula is implemented in the computer. And this is a very important topic. I believe that whenever you look at numerical methods, you have to have an understanding of this stuff, at least the basic understanding that there are some hidden problems. Yeah? So if not, it can happen that you write some code that copies a formula that you read in a paper and that looks like it solves a mathematical problem, and the solution that is calculated is completely wrong. And the biggest problem is that it may happen that you don't see that the solution is wrong. So a high-level programming language usually hides all these details. Yeah? So if you use Java, Scala, or frameworks like R, MATLAB, Mathematica, then this is often hidden from you. And it may be that you naively believe that the stuff that you are typing is one-to-one the mathematical function you believe that it is, but the computer implementation actually gives you a wrong result. And it's really important that a programmer needs to be aware of this, and of course a mathematician too. In the next sessions, I look mainly at floating point numbers and the way floating point numbers are implemented in the computer. So this is called IEEE 754, which is the standard that is used in many programming languages and also in frameworks that do floating point arithmetic. And there is here this nice little article, which you find in the references. So if you go here to the link number one, there is this link. And if you open this link, you can read here this nice little article where you can find many, many more details on this topic. And the title is really true. Yeah? So what every computer scientist should know about floating point arithmetic. So that's a nice read. Okay, so I really recommend you to have a look here at this page. But I will start with integers. Okay, so this looks a little bit trivial. Yeah? So integers, well, the computer can represent a certain subset of Z, so integer numbers. Of course, he can only represent a finite subset. So he represents k between some bounds, integer min value here and integer max value. Okay, and these bounds depends a little bit on the implementation. So if you use 32 bits in a computer, you can represent 2 to the power of 32 numbers. And since I also like to represent negative numbers, so if it is assigned integers, you know, I have to choose where I put my minimum and my maximum of this interval. So usual implementations use the min value to be here at minus 2 to the power of 31, and the max value is then 2 to the power of 31 minus 1. So you have here some numbers. So let me draw this. Yeah, so we have 0 here, 1 here, and then you have some numbers. And there is a largest possible number in your representation. So here this is 2 to the power of 31 minus 1. So including the 0, yeah, these guys here are 2 to the power of 31 numbers. Okay, and then you have the negative numbers, minus one, minus two, and so on. And the smallest possible number is then minus two to the power of 31. So that you have in total here again, 2 to the power of 31 numbers. So I use in total 2 to the power of 32 numbers. Okay, so these are my integers. Okay, so you see there is a bound here. Okay, and the question is, what happens if I take the largest possible number in the computer and I add 1 to it? Good question. So do you have a guess? So maybe you can guess it. And if I don't know the answer, I just try it. So I like to do this with you here. So let's create a Java class where we perform a small experiment. I select here that you should create a main method, and let's call this integer arithmetic experiments. So he will create a main method for me so I can write some code here that is later executed. And let's have a nice comment here. So we have some experiments related to integers. Okay, so let's create this integer. So there is the class integer in Java, and you can ask this class, okay, what is the max value? So he tells you a constant holding the maximum value of an integer, so which is 2 to the power of 31 minus 1, so exactly as I explained. So I can just ask him, okay, give me this maximum possible value. So let's print this out. So I is equal to I. So let's run the program. And he will print this number. Okay, so maybe I make a small headline here. So in case this looks a bit nicer in the output, and also print what this I is. So I is equal to integer dot max value. Yeah. So what I did now is just I'm printing a little bit more description. Yeah. So nothing has happened. Okay. So I have here the printout what this I is. So let's do some calculation. Yeah? So I define a new variable, which is called I plus one. So I'm calling this variable I plus one. And I plus one is the result of I plus one. And let's print this guy. So here is I plus one. So let's write here I plus one. And this is I plus one. Okay, and now let's run this program. Okay, and the result is minus 2 to the power of 31. So actually, he just is flipping around to the other side, and there's no error. Huh? No error message at all. Yeah? No warning. Hey guys, something has happened. So for example, if you do some test, yeah, so some test of the ordering, and this test is now a Boolean, yeah, true or false, and this test is I plus one larger than I? So if you now print this, if you now print this, you see that the test is false. So let's make this printout a bit nicer. So I plus one larger than I was the test that we do. And the result is I plus one larger than I is false. So I have a clear violation of the ordering. So this is a certain set, and at certain bounds, some intuitive stuff is violated, and you have to be aware of this. Well, this is maybe just an example. Yeah, of course, you have to be aware that something happens if you cross the bound, but the things that we will see for floating point numbers are much more subtle. Okay, so here's the question. What happens if I is the max value and we add one to it? So that is our code session. I have here the link to the code, which you can check out from GitHub, where you can find this code and where you can just run it. And the answer is that if I add one to it, I get the minimum value. Okay, so there is some flipping to the other side. So the intuition here is that actually this line of numbers, which I have drawn on the previous page, so where we have here the numbers and here is the max value. So that is the maximum possible value. And here I have the negative ones and here is the minimum possible value. Okay, this is actually forming a kind of a circle. So this is forming a kind of a circle where you have here the maximum number and here you have the minimum number and here I have zero. And when you perform an arithmetic operation on this, it's just running around the circle. Yeah. So running around the circle, so plus one moves you to the minimum. Okay, so arithmetic operations run along this circle. So in other words, you can say that the set Z is structured into equivalent classes. So this is now the integer arithmetic. So the conclusion is that we have a certain integer arithmetic. So if I is the set of integers, so if I here is the set of integers, then if you have a mathematical function, so there is here now g, let's have g operate on I times I, but it maps to z. So this guy here is now the mathematical function. So g from I times I maps to z is the mathematical function. Then we have a computer implementation of this function. So g tilde. And g tilde has its result in I. So this here is the implementation. Of g. And it maps to the set I, and actually we are choosing the equivalence class that corresponds to G mod 2 to the power of 32. Okay, so actually G tilde is chosen such that G tilde plus some X times 2 to the power of 32 is equal to g. So you don't get the exact same value, you can just get the value that represents the equivalence class. So in other words, we represent an equivalent class. Okay, so that was my session on integers. Next session is on floating point numbers.